I went to the College of Worcester in 1941, expecting to be an English and Latin teacher. And then in December 1941 was Pearl Harbor. And the fellows left in droves from the campus. And the house mother at dinner one time said, "You know, we girls have got to step up and do science." And she said, "You're taking chemistry, aren't you, Helen?" I said, "Yeah." "Get good grades." I got all A's. And she said, "Why don't you switch?" And I said, "Okay." just boing like that.
Two scientists living in Indiana in the 1950s were married couple Helen and Al Free. Both worked as research scientists at Miles Laboratory.
Well, I'm Jake Free, and my parents are Helen and Al Free, and they developed the dip and read test for sugar and urine. My parents they wanted people to know how fun science could be.
It's a very fun field to be in. Being in chemistry, being in engineering, the innovation part is so much fun. It's so cool is the word I'm gonna use because I'm kind of nerdy, I guess. But just being involved, working with people in this industry, whether it's another scientist or an engineer, marketing person, a lawyer, it's working with those people to bring all of this science together in a package and deliver it out to the people, to the hospitals, the physicians, is a blast.
Strike. Strike without warning.
It was the beginning of World War II. Pearl Harbor had happened. My mom was at Worcester at the time. She was studying Latin, and I think her house mother might have inspired her, but she was inspired to say, hey, the women need to move into scientific fields. So she decided to get into chemistry and kind of test that out. But by the time that was rolling, she was way into chemistry and she was on a roll. She loved it. She was really good at it. She was good at it her whole life. She was a really, really good scientist and a really good chemist.
In 1941, Miles Laboratories had developed a tablet for testing the level of glucose in the urine of diabetes patients, called Clinitest. Made by the inventors of Alka-Seltzer, the Clinitest tablets fizzed and produced a color change when placed in a test tube with the patient's urine. It was the first diagnostic test of its kind, as it could be done outside of the laboratory in a doctor's office.
I can't really remember when I first discovered or realized that my parents were scientists. By the time I was 6 years old, I had known how to run Clinitests. And that was basically where you take 5 drops of urine, 10 drops of water, and you put the tablet in, and it gives it an exothermic boiling reaction. And when that was done, after a certain amount of time, you'd check the color to see if you had sugar or not.
The research group, led by Al and Helen Free, was charged with making the clinitest tablet more sensitive and easier to use. They succeeded with the invention of a urine dipstick called Clinistix.
Now the problem with the tablet, I mean, it was great, it was a boon to science, but it still took a lot of manipulation in a laboratory by a scientist. So one of the scientists at Miles' lab, Dr. Al Free, said to his wife Helen Free, you know, wouldn't it be something if we could simplify this? If we could make it easier for the lab people to test? What if we could put it on paper? So fast forward to 1956, and Helen Free develops the urine dipstick for glucose. Helen's daughter-in-law, Cheryl Free, told me that she was with Helen at a lecture Helen gave in retirement. A woman stood up in the audience to thank her for her invention and said, Helen, my daughter would not be here had you not invented that test strip, because I'm a type 1 diabetic and it wasn't considered safe in my era to get pregnant and deliver a child.
The Frees had succeeded in inventing what would become the now ubiquitous dip and read urine strip, and both Al and Helen Free went on to influence the industry in major ways. Al led the research laboratory at Miles and became a vice president in charge of technical services and scientific relations in the 70s. Both Frees have been inducted into the National Inventors Hall of Fame. Helen became a champion for science education and went on to receive the National Medal of Honor from President Obama.
So Helen Free and the Free family here in Northern Indiana, I mean, that's a name that everybody really recognizes. They've made a huge impact on the area and on global health with their inventions and just their legacy.
Meeting Helen and Al Free were like meeting movie stars. You know, I got kind of nervous, tongue-tied, I didn't know what to say. And over the years, she actually would come out and hear our band. I would see her watching our music, and I was so thrilled to have her there.
I was at an event at the Elkhart Business Legacy Hall of Fame where Helen Free was receiving recognition for her contribution to science, but particularly as a woman in business as well. And I just remember being struck by the fact that she did not want to accept credit for the work that she did.
But why was this invention by the Frees so important? What is a urine test used for? And how is it made?
Everyone who goes to their doctor has a urine test. I think it would be hard to find anyone watching this who hasn't had a urine sample analyzed.
A urine test is, you know, it's the summation of what all your organs do. You know, your body either secretes what your organs do and the body doesn't want to keep, or sometimes it actually doesn't secrete, which is also important because sometimes it uses things that it shouldn't be using and it doesn't actually show up in the urine.
And that's why a urine test is so great, because without any sort of needles or challenging equipment, a clinician in nearly any clinical setting can get really, really fast information about what might be happening inside the body to then spur on future testing or investigation.
Urinalysis is important because, one, it's a non-invasive sample, so which is easy to get. Two, in a couple of minutes, you can get a lot of information. Get your glucose, you can find out if you have a UTI, you can find out your liver function.
You take the dipstick out of the container and you dip it in the urine, you pull it out of the urine, you daub the sides a little bit to get any excess urine off, and then you're watching a timer and you're reading the pads at the appropriate interval.
Well, there's a lot going on in each of the strips. Some of them are strict chemical reactions, other are enzymatically driven, like glucose.
A urine test is comprised of a piece of plastic backing with different test pads attached to it. That's then dipped in the sample and gives the doctor lots of different pieces of information for each one of those test pads. For example, leukocytes and nitrites could be an early indicator of a UTI.
At this facility, we produce millions of meters of reagent strips each month that we do supply across the world. The urine strips that were built, you know, when they were first developed, were hand-dipped with drying racks. So producing the urinalysis strips is a multi-step process. The line behind me is just part of that process, where we'll take a 12-inch roll of paper and slit it to 1/5-inch strips on all these spools behind us. It'd go through a dip, It comes through here, as you can see behind me, and it gets spooled up onto all these spools, and then they're finally placed on cards. That process, going from where we started to where we are now, allows us to be able to confidently and consistently provide these strips.
A urinalysis medical device, they're usually pretty small, especially the ones in point of care, about a little bit smaller than a toaster. And there's a tray that the user places their test strip on, and then the tray will automatically pull in at the right time, because everything's very time dependent, and it'll automatically measure the image of the strips to detect color and intensity of the lines to determine what the result is depending on the test.
The strip is illuminated with six different wavelengths from LEDs. The light is reflected off of the strip pads, back up to a mirror, and then into a detector. And once those are, once you have those readings, then those give you the same readings that you might get visually, but you can do it in a minute. And they don't have to turn the bottle, they don't have to, you know, do the visual reads at given times. So it's a much easier way to actually run urine strips.
Urinalysis equipment and automated urine strip analyzers were developed to reduce the amount of interpretation error that may occur just by people visually reading urine strips. Machines came into the equation to try to eliminate a lot of those factors. They have their own light source, they can interpret the color much the way that your eyes do, and they're automatically timed, so we don't have to worry about whether or not you've looked at it in the right amount of time on the bottle.
People have different eyesight, and in fact, we did some studies, at least on HCG, which is also in urine, where we gave strips with different colors on it, had 12 different lines at different intensities, and had people read them. And we found out that some people could see a line that wasn't there. Other people couldn't see the darkest line. So you had a lot of variability in being able to read. And what the instrument does is it takes that out, because it's gonna read the same every single time.
We've also branched out in really trying to connect that strip with our instrument to information systems. So getting our data across to laboratory information systems, hospital information systems, and in the physician's office lab to their systems as well. So really about communicating and taking that data and transporting it across so that the physicians, the doctors in the hospitals can really look at that data real time.
When tests are being manufactured, at that volume, there's an incredible requirement to make sure that from urine strip and from test to test, that those tests give the same results as often as possible.
Quality is essential to what we do because real people are going to be depending on these results to make decisions. And so quality goes into every aspect of what we do, from design to manufacturing.
So the field of urinalysis, when I first started, was really focused on the chemistry of the strip, the pads on that strip. And today, I think we've started to branch out in the last 10 or 15 years. And a few of those areas are around quality. So we're able to tell on those urine strips today if we have a quality product, if it's been exposed to the environment, if it's run out of its shelf life or hit its expiration date. Those are the things that are also important to the hospital and the physician's office lab today.
We've been manufacturing reagents, urinalysis reagents, in the Elkhart area 40 or 50 plus years. And a lot of the people who work in manufacturing especially have worked for the company for a long time. And so we have a lot of experienced people here who really know what they're doing and know how to produce the product and then control it and release it. And it's the people who really help us provide that continuity between the past and today.
Today, urine tests are made and shipped all around the world so that people in areas where there aren't hospitals, where there might not even be clinics, they might be few and far between, can use a visual read system. And then there are analyzers from everywhere, from a physician office to an emergency department to a full-scale giant lab. And all along the way, the same urine chemistry is used for consistency of results. That leads us to reliable, repeatable results that physicians and patients can trust. And did you know that urine strips actually were on the moonshot. When Neil Armstrong, a fellow Ohioan, walked on the moon, urine test strips were in that capsule, just in case they needed it.
The work here that Al and Helen did had such an impact that it's been recognized on the record of National Historic Places. There's a plaque at the original factory where these were made. That's a testament to how innovative these products really were and how they changed the clinical landscape.
Over 80 years ago, Helen developed the urinalysis test strip here. After 80 years, we still continue to build on that, and we want to keep that going. That legacy, that heritage is very important, and we take pride in that. We know that what she did and what we're doing today, we will still continue to do tomorrow.
There are so many different tests out there, and throughout the years, with all the innovation that goes on in medicine, which is so exciting, it's really interesting to take stock for a minute and remember that actually a really basic test, such as the humble urine dipstick, is still as critical today as it was all the way when it was invented.
It's clear that urine testing has stood the test of time. And thanks to a husband and wife team of biochemists who revolutionized diagnostic urine testing with the invention of today's urine test strip, we continue to rely on quality urinalysis as a modern tool of healthcare. But where is urine to go from here? And with the growing burden of chronic disease throughout the world, how can urine be leveraged as a solution? Find out on our next episodes.
What's next in the treasure trove, Bill?
Let me look and see. Here we have a picture of a very young Helen and Alfred.
Oh, I recognize this picture. This is very well publicized online, right?
What are they in front of?
They're there in the lab.
Yeah.
They were trials.
And they developed that first glucose test.
I think there was already a glucose oxidase test, and they just made it point of care, like basically the first point
of care.
No,
but was it always, format's pretty interesting, right? I mean, because of
it was a tablet first.
Yeah, I was going to say, because
Clinitas.
The original test.